1996, and we had the roll call by the town clerk, please.
Chairman Cogstall?
Here.
Counselor Chapel?
Yeah.
Counselor Jordan?
Yeah.
Counselor Linnell?
Here.
Counselor McGinty?
Here.
Counselor McLaughlin?
Here.
And Counselor Reed?
Here.
You'd all join us in the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The first item tonight is citizens' discussion period of items not on the agenda. There being no one who wishes to make a comment on items not on the agenda, we'll move on to reports and correspondence.
Madam Chairman?
Mr. Chapel?
I wanted everybody to know that the flow control that we've been looking for regional waste systems failed in the House, 272 to 148, on January the 31st, last week ago, Friday. This makes it very important that this new committee that we have formed over there, subcommittee to study regional waste services revenue, becomes more important than ever before, because that flow control is not going to come back in 1996. And it's doubtful if it ever does, when you get a vote 2 to 1. So we're meeting on the 15th, which is Thursday, at 4:30 in the afternoon, the subcommittee, until 6:30 or 7, and then the whole board will be meeting at 7 o'clock, and I'll be reporting to you what our progress is at the next meeting. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other reports, correspondence? Counselor Linnell?
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I have two things to mention. One is, we are recruiting people from Cape Elizabeth for a new committee to study the school service delivery options. This is an outgrowth of a committee which studied the town service delivery options, various things, functions the town performs. It was very successful. And so we're analyzing, this committee would analyze essentially everything that the school department does, except for the curriculum aspect in terms of transportation, maintenance, and so forth. And we've gotten several strong applications. We still would encourage anyone interested to stop at the town hall and pick up an application and a charge of exactly what it involves. Secondly, I just wanted to let you know that I've been selected to serve on the National League of Cities Steering Committee on Energy, Environment, and Natural Resources. A few weeks ago, I was selected to serve on the Policy Committee of that organization, and I'm real pleased to have been selected to be on the Steering Committee as well. It involves a couple extra trips to Washington and so forth, and unless it's my turn to go, I'll bear the expense myself. Thank you.
Arthur? Any other reports? Counselor McLaughlin?
Thank you, Madam Chairman. On Wednesday, January 24th, the Greater Portland Council of Governments Executive Committee met and had what in my mind was one of the more exciting sessions with that group. We had what they were calling Commissioners Roundtable. We had Evan Rickett, who's the Commissioner of the State Planning Office, Ned Sullivan, who's the DEP Commissioner, and Paul Miner was there representing the Department of Transportation. Had a very lively question and answer period. Some of the information that they passed on to us that I thought was worthy of sharing with you folks was that they're being encouraged by the governor to take a team approach to municipal activities, to be customer-oriented, and to have interagency programs. And I did take the opportunity, I think the counselors will appreciate, to directly speak to the representative from the Department of Transportation and encourage them to let communities go through design process without committing to funding for final construction. And was able to make that point. I don't know how well it was received or if anything will come of it, but it was a treat to be able to make the point that we've been making in this chamber to somebody who might be able to do something about it. Another meeting I've attended recently was the Zoning Ordinance Rewrite Committee. I know we have a number of councilors on that committee. It's chaired by Chairman Cogsall, actually. And I was impressed with the work being done with that committee. I was just sitting at the side, I was not partaking, but just the very hard work, a lot of good dedicated people, some wonderful lively minds at those meetings. And when that does come to the council, we will, I imagine, be referring it to the Planning Board. I hope that we can have a good number of sessions where it's a joint Planning Board and Town Council review of the work that comes out of the ZORC Committee, so we can move it along and not go through a lot of redundancy for people, including the council and its staff. Thank you.
One other thing, Madam Chairman.
Yes.
The Space Study Committee, I have never made a report on that, and I think I better, because it'll be the last time, because next month you'll receive it in your packet, our report, where our final meeting is tomorrow night. We've got everything firmed up and ready to go. And usually, you know, we get everything done, and then we receive it, and we thank the committee. Well, I'm going to reverse it and thank them now, because with the report being in, and everybody interested in that, sometimes the committee is left kind of out. I'm not going to list all the names, because you'll see that on the report, but they have been just wonderful. 5 years ago, we had the committee formed, and we worked on it, and we built the highway garage, and looked at the other buildings at the same time. This time, we've given it a further look with the same criteria, updating it, looking ahead 10 to 15 to 20 years, and we'll have that report for you next meeting. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Reed.
Yes, Madam Chair. I did want to report to the public that the P2 Committee, the Pedals and Pedestrian Committee, continues to meet. Our next meeting is February 21st. We will be looking at the Greenbelt and trails, among other agenda items. And just a reminder that the public is invited to attend any and all meetings. Thank you.
Any other reports? I'll call upon our town clerk, Debbie Lane.
Thank you very much, Chairman Cogsall. Just a reminder that nomination papers for council and school board will be available in my office beginning on Wednesday, February 24th. They are due back on Monday, March 25th. We have 2 seats on the town council and 2 seats on the school board that are available. Thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to commend our rescue and police units for their quick response and very professional handling of a serious accident last evening. It's reassuring to know that we do have this kind of service available. I'm going to build upon what Councilor Nell said about the ZORC Committee. It's starting to become a little bit of a buzzword because it's such an unusual name. But we had a public call-in forum on the 31st that was on cable TV. And we also had a Great Pond Watershed forum inviting people in the, excuse me, to emphasize one of the new aspects of an approach to conservation. We are planning to complete, we hope, our report by the end of March and have a general public meeting on the general policy issues that have been have proposed changes. Excuse me, I'm having problems tonight. So then it will be passed on to the council and we'll go from there. Just a little update that I want to commend the Cape Elizabeth Lions Club, which is donating $4,750 towards new furniture for the children's side of the library. They are always coming forth and helping in the community. We're fortunate to have such an active group in the community. On to minutes of meetings. Number, excuse me.
Yes. Madam Chair, I believe when the clerk was talking about nomination papers being available, she misspoke one of the dates. It's Wednesday the 14th.
What did I say? Wednesday the 14th.
Thank you. That they're available.
All right. 2 days.
On to minutes of meetings, number 12 and number 13. Any corrections or additions? I'll have a motion, please.
Madam Chair, I move we accept the minutes.
Second.
All in favor? 7-0 on both. Then we move on to our public hearing for proposed revised sewer rates. Mr. McGovern, if you would give us the background information on this item, please.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairman. About a year ago, the town council urged us to begin to look at sewer rates and how we might address them with a number of issues, including what the minimum fee is, as well as what the incremental fee. As a result of some meetings with the then sewer committee, in addition to a workshop that the town council held several months ago, a proposal was developed that whereby the current minimum monthly fee of $31 would be reduced to $26.50. The incremental fee per 100 cubic feet would be increased from $3 to $3.82. And the availability charge that is charged for some homes that have not yet connected to the sewer would be reduced from $28 to zero, essentially eliminating the fee. It's also proposed that the connection fee for those that had been paying the availability charge increase from $830 to $850, and for those that haven't paid the fee to be reduced from $3,288 to $2,700, and that these fees be effective with the next billing round at the Portland Water District. That's a summary of the proposal.
Thank you. Is there anyone here who wishes to speak on this item? Public hearing is open. There being none, I'll close the public hearing. We do have correspondence from Richard Dahlbeck in reference to primarily, I guess it was the readiness to serve fee. It was his concern that he's already been paying for a number of years. We have the proposal of reducing the readiness to serve fee and reducing the sewer rates. I have a bit of a concern about reducing the rate at this moment, since we had a workshop on January 29th with the Portland Water District, in which they informed us that in order to meet the new DEP and EPA standards, we need to chlorinate more of our effluent, and that will end up costing a considerable amount of money, which they don't at this moment know what it will be. They need to work up the proposals. I think I'd like the council to discuss the idea of lowering a rate and then having to raise it back up again when we're not really sure what it's going to be, and then also dealing with the readiness to serve. Comments? Councilor Now.
Well, just one thought. I think one of the strengths of this proposal is that it rewards people that conserve water, and it charges those who use more water. And so I guess it wouldn't bother me particularly if we went ahead with it, and we could adjust it later to reflect other costs.
Rosemary?
Do we have a time frame for when the implementation of the improvements will be?
December 13th, 1996, at the moment, is the compliance schedule.
Madam Chair?
Oh, the two of you are just...
I'm done.
You're done, okay.
I'm trying to...
Councilor McGinty.
You know, this has been a contentious issue, water rates, sewer rates, over the years. I would prefer to give the sewer customers, you know, the lower rate now. If it's going to be 8 months, that's fine. If they can enjoy lower rates for 8 months, I think we should give them that opportunity. And if we have to raise them again in December because of this chlorination issue, then we should address it then. But if we can give a break on the sewer rates now, I think we should do it.
Is there a Councilor Jordan?
No, I have a question for the manager. Isn't built into this right here a cushion in case there is increase through the year, or is this right down to the bad penny for the payoff?
This proposal is intended to be revenue neutral. I did a spreadsheet run, two spreadsheet runs, one with the current based on the number of customers at each usage level, and one on the new rate. And the new rate shows that it's a few pennies, a few dollars higher, but it's you know, within half a 1%.
Counsel McGinnity?
That was a question I was going to have, is what if it isn't neutral revenue? What if it doesn't generate the monies that we need? What happens then?
We run that risk every time we set rates. It looks reasonably good that we're not going to have much of a problem. You know, and as I look at the spreadsheets here, where the shifts occur, it's, you know, most of the revenue is within those in the usage from 0 to 10 anyway. And, you know, particularly as you get the higher ends of that, your minimum's going to be going up. Your minimum's going to be going down while your incremental's going up. So, you know, it's going to be, it's the same pool of funds just being churned around so that it essentially gives a break, as Counselor Nell has mentioned, to those with less use. But it is revenue neutral, and, you know, we could lose a few dollars under it. But I would like to mention that there had been discussion on actually reducing the revenue requirement by $40,000. And at one point in time, at one of the early council workshops, the council suggested that that not be done because of some of the factors that you're discussing. So we do have that, the $40,000 leeway in there. Well, what we're discussing is a total revenue income of about $1.21 million.
Thank you.
Is there a motion?
Madam
Chair. We're working hard tonight.
Well, I move that we approve the draft rate policy.
Second motion.
Any other discussion? Councilor Reed.
Just that when we pass this, if we could somehow send a warning to people that this could only be a 10-month reduction, and that we are going to try to do what's in their best interest by lowering it. Well, I'm voting to lower it tonight, if that's the will of the council, but just a warning, it's not a long-term, may not be a long-term rate.
No further discussion. All those in favor of the rates as proposed? 7-0. On to our second public hearing, the proposed condemnation of 537 Shore Road. Mr. McGovern, if you would update us on this, please.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairman. I think, as everyone is aware, last July there was a fire at what is commonly known as the Basics Building, which is across from the Cookie Jar. It was a building that had the Basic store in it, plus a couple of apartments upstairs located at 537 Shore Road. The building inspector has been working with the owner of the property since the time of the fire, as well as the fire chief, to encourage them to move along with repairs of the structure. For a long time, the progress was very slow, and we began to get phone calls from citizens wondering what was going on. A couple of months ago, we indicated, the building inspector indicated to Mr. Burgess, the owner of the property, that we would be going to the council requesting a condemnation of the building for it to be torn down. In response to that, Mr. Burgess did get the message that if he wanted to retain his equity in the property, that he best begin to make improvements. He has made some improvements. Primarily, I think everyone has seen, a new roof has gone on to the structure, and in more recent weeks, the roof has been shingled as well. However, as everyone looks at the building, one can see that aesthetically, not too many improvements have been made. You still have the burned-out siding, burned-out side to the structure, and there needs to be continuous progress. One of the difficulties is, when you have a building like that, it can become attractive to less desirable elements and attractive to someone maybe wanting to encourage some further activity within the building. So therefore, you know, in recognition of some progress that has been made, the staff is recommending at this point that you not condemn the building this evening, but that you instead keep this pending and give them a 2-month notice until your April meeting to see continuous and further improvements in the structure. Thank you.
Councilor Reed.
I agree with that, and I would make the motion, but I had a question.
We need to have a public hearing first.
Oh, excuse me.
Just in case someone is here for it.
Yeah, Ernest McVane, the building inspector, is here as well, should anyone have any questions for Ernie?
Mr. McVane, did you actually receive a written report from that structure?
I haven't received the report yet.
Still haven't received it?
I expected it by today, and it hasn't come.
Okay, so it's been 7 days.
I met with the engineer, and everything seemed to be in order, and I'm sure it's coming, we just haven't received it yet.
Is there anyone here who wishes to speak in this public hearing on this item? There being none, I'll close the public hearing. Councilor Reed, you had a question?
Yes, I had a question. Michael referred to 2 months. I believe it's an April 8th meeting, it's not really 2 months. Could we say to a specific date in April, like April 1st, I'm not looking at a calendar, so that we'll have time to get the information and not have it in the mail, if you will, like the engineer's report is tonight?
What my suggestion was is that you table it to the April meeting.
Okay.
Make that a motion?
Yes. Do you want a motion?
I didn't know if there were any other questions. I'll take a motion.
Madam Chair, I move that we table item 99 until our April meeting in order to ensure progress continuing on this project.
Second it.
Further discussion? Councilor McGinty.
Is that still the code enforcement officer's recommendation in light of the fact that he didn't receive the report, that we table it?
Yes.
Any other discussion? All in favor of tabling? 7-0. Item number 100, to consider a request for a quitclaim deed from Joan and
Jesus
Guevara for property situated 882 Shore Road and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairman. The town, in its property collection procedures, property tax collection procedures, follows the Maine state statutes. First, we send out a number of tax bills for properties, then we send notices of liens, 30-day notices, then lien notices, and then 30-day notice of foreclosures. This particular property we foreclosed on January 15, 1996, as a result of the taxes not having been paid that were first due in May of 1994 for the fiscal year 1994. Subsequently, taxes were not paid for the following fiscal year, and were also not paid for October of this past year. In addition, there'll be a balance due of an additional $7,262 in April, along with all the other taxes. We had sent notices to the address 882 Shore Road. Most of them were unclaimed. We did have one of the notices that was claimed, signed by an individual. Subsequent to the foreclosure, I called one of the neighbors of this property, who informed me that perhaps I could reach the property owners in Dallas, Texas. I called directory assistance in Texas and received two numbers for this family in Texas of the same name. One of them ultimately did turn out to be the proper one. Had discussions with them, as well as their attorney who's here this evening. Subsequent to the discussions, they immediately forwarded a check for the full amount owed of taxes, interest, and fees through the April due date, an amount approximating $37,590.13. Thank you, Madam Chairman.
Thank you. I believe the first taxes that were delinquent started with October 1993.
Thank you.
We started with 1994. Does Ms. Lane have anything she wants to add?
Not this time.
Council discussion? Councilor Jordan.
I just want to know, I don't know if they have any comment or not, but had the taxes been paid properly up until the last few years, each year, from what date on? 1980-something up until?
Yeah, they, I think the property, I don't know the exact date, was purchased about 10 years ago. That could be corrected by their attorney or by the owners here this evening. But yes, they had been paid quite regularly up until this point.
So it's kind of been a mix-up as far as where they were sent and they didn't get forwarded on. Is that a fair assessment of it?
I don't know if I'm the judge of that. I know we sent them to the address that we'd been given and where they'd initially been sent. And to my knowledge, the tax office was not notified of a change of address.
Thank you.
Counsel McGinty.
On the registered letter that was received and signed for, who signed for that?
It looks like an Ed Combes or something, C-O-M-B-E-S or something like that.
Mr. Rich, you want to come to the podium, please? Over, we have to come over here, please. To the microphone, with the telephone, for the camera.
Well, this is the first time I'm here. I'm a Mexican citizen. I came to this beautiful area, excuse me. First of all, I would like you, excuse me, my bad English because it's my second language.
Would you just tell...
If you don't understand me, please, I stop and you can ask.
Mr. Senor Guevara, would you tell us for the record your name?
My name is Jesus Guevara.
Thank you, okay.
My profession is physician. I have been working as a surgeon for 40 years. I work in Mexico City. And I'm going to give you a small story about why I came here, because some of you have to think why so far to come to this place. First of all, my wife is from this country. We have a son. We love always New England to come around every year. One day, my wife asked me, then she saw in a magazine a beautiful house, then she, that was a dream to come to live. That is the reason I came with her. And when we saw the house, that was the house that I really wanted when I could retire to my profession, my work. For that reason, my boy was very small, 8, 9 years old in that time. He came here and he went to the school, to the Cape Elizabeth School. He was very happy here. He was involved in all the sports here. My wife also was involved in voluntary works for the Cancer Society and Symphonic and all those things. I had to commute from Mexico City to here, and you have to imagine the far that it is. But nevertheless, I think that that was worth it because, like I told you, I believe this is one of the most beautiful places to be. For the safety, first of all, and also in a boy, that age of my boy, was it wonderful to be here, so secure, and we didn't have any problems to let him go to play or whatever. Then she came back here. She came for the first time to live. We bought this place in 83, virtually. And a few months after, they wanted to move to this place. They were here 5 years. 5 years, beautiful years. But after 5 years, I thought that was very hard for me to commute so far. And then I asked them that if they could move to the south in the meantime, when I could be stop my working in my profession, and then to come here to live to the last years. Then she accepted, she moved to Dallas. And in that time, there was a lady, a widow, that offered us to pay attention to the house. In relation mainly, you know your weather here, the furnace that could be working and do not have a problem with the house. Then in the same time, she was receiving all the mail and to send it to Mexico, part to me, part to my wife. I say part to me because the big bills was for me and the smallest for my wife. When this was working beautifully, but unfortunately, 2.5 years ago, more or less, this lady started with problems to forget things and to forget to send the mail. And after a few months, we discovered that she started with the terrible problems of Alzheimer. Now she is in a place where they take care for her. And that was exactly the question that was why we have been doing right our obligations as the 93. That was because we receive all the mail and we can pay all our obligations that we always have done. This problem that we didn't pay for these 2 years was not an omission, was a confusion. Confusion that my wife thought that because it was the normal thing that this lady used to send the big bills and was taxes in there, I was paying. And I thought because this lady was not in good condition now, was sending to her in Dallas the bills. And I thought everything was paid without no problem. Besides, I have in the last 2 years I have been working harder, and sometimes I said that I should retire already, and in this moment I'm working more than ever in my life. You know, Mexico have problems, and we have to work harder to overcome in many ways. These problems was mainly because they create this, but the biggest problem that we have in this moment has been created because we never received notification. This is very important to tell about it, because I'm sure that the town sent all those certificates, letters that you say, but we have never received. I want to tell you this: when in 1988 and my wife came back to Dallas, in that time she, even after years, when she knew that this lady was not doing right, she notified to the police and to the alarm system company. And also she called to the town, and some secretary or somebody answered her and took the address of Dallas in case that something could be necessary to call. Normally we come the most frequent than we can to pass here 2, 3, 4, 5 days every time, like I said, because we love the place. Now, we didn't receive this, and like the confusion is that I thought was paying everything and she thought that I has been paying. The proof of this is when we really have a notification. Immediately, the second day after I heard about it, I sent the check for everything that they asked me to do it. Why I send that check? Because for me, this house is very, very important. This is my place where I want to pass the last years of my life. I was in love from the first time I saw him. We have been in the most wonderful community with all the people. We have never had any problem in those 5 years that she was here. On the contrary, we have meetings and good time all together. Then this is a beautiful place, and I really would like to pass the rest of my life for all those reasons that I have told you about it. There was one thing that concerned me. This is the first time, believe me, I'm in front of people to explain something that could hurt me. I have been here in this country, and I'm going to show you my visa. My visa is a permanent visa that the United States government gave it to me in 1959 for all my life. I have not had any small problem never in this country. Even the license to driving I have from that time in the United States. I have not had one ticket in all those years. I respect tremendously all the things here in this country, like in mine. I want to tell you that in the way of my profession, I was the personal physician of the president in Mexico for 1964 to 70, in the time that you have a great president, Lyndon Johnson, and I served to your president in that time, because he went to Mexico several times, and I was in charge of all his problems. I received a beautiful letter from him, and he invited me to visit his ranch and the White House in several occasions. I've been working, I know I have not done but my best in my life, and these things really, it has been shocking me a little bit. In this moment I have too much work in Mexico, but Peter then is a wonderful friend that I am knowing from the first time I came here. He said you have to be, to talk with all these ladies and gentlemen in relation with this problem and to try to overcome the problem. That's what we want, and that was what I ask all of you. That was, like I said again, a confusion, and the proof is that for 10 years before, we never fail any moment in to pay the taxes, and we will never fail again. That is all what I have to tell you. I am very pleased to be here. I have been enjoying these cold days that I have not had in Mexico in this moment. And I think for you, after so many cold days, you don't like it so much. For me, it's new to see the snow and all those beautiful things and the ocean. Thank you very
Thank
much.
Thank you, Senor. Comments from the council? Do we want a motion?
I have a couple questions, actually.
You want to ask who?
Senor
Rivera?
Yes, or Ms. Rich, either one.
All right. Peter, do you or Dr. Guevara want to answer the questions? Hey, John.
My first question is...
Yeah, for the record, my name is Peter Rich, and I'm the attorney here tonight for Jesus and Joan Guevara.
Once this person who was taking care of the house was no longer able to do what she was doing, wasn't there any consideration of how the mail was now going to get to Dallas or to Mexico? How did he expect the mail to be forwarded?
They thought they had made arrangements for the important mail to be delivered. They had called the Union Oil, they'd called Eastern, and they thought they'd called the town. Apparently there was a misunderstanding and it hadn't gone through, but they'd called the people that they thought that bills most likely would be coming from to have the mail directly sent either to Dallas or to Mexico City. And that's how they thought they had taken care of it.
The second thing is, and maybe this is more directed towards them than you, didn't they ever sit down and talk to each other about now that this woman was not here and they weren't receiving their tax bills? I mean, well, I just can't understand how for 3 years you'd forget about your taxes being, you know, in a house you have several thousand miles away.
Well, understand that the things that trigger us as we are citizens here may not be the same as would trigger someone in Mexico City. For example, I learned that the custom is not to have an accountant do your taxes every year because the tax structure is entirely different. Dr. Guevara would assure you, would tell you that he does his own accounting every year, okay? And so there is no backup built into it as I would have, let's say, my accountant call me and say, how about that check to the town of Cape Elizabeth for taxes? You paid that in December, didn't you, as opposed to in March? And I would tell him yes. It doesn't happen that way in a different country, in a different culture.
Counselor Reed.
I'm so used to people complaining about their taxes that it just, it's amazing to me. And maybe your explanation was that it's in the countries that someone would overlook a tax deduction of that scope.
Excuse me, there is no deduction against Mexican income for taxes paid in the United States to the town of Cape Elizabeth, so it's a non-issue.
Thank you. That was important to me. I wanted to know, how could someone avoid for 3 years this deduction?
You want to know? I asked the same question of them.
Thank you.
Any other questions of Mr. Rich or Dr. Guevara? If not, I'll take a motion.
Madam Chair.
Counsel McLaughlin.
I would like to request that we go into an executive session. We have town attorney here. I just need to make sure I have a good client attorney relationship with him so I understand some of the ramifications of what we may be coming up with. So I would move that we go into an executive session for the express purpose to discuss property acquisition and disposition matters and receive advice from legal counsel.
I'll second that.
All those in favor? All those opposed? Are you going to vote?
I don't want to go into an executive session, if that's what you mean.
Then you should be voting in the opposition.
Yeah.
That's what I'm calling for. All those opposed to going into executive session for consultation with the attorney in reference to this matter? Okay, it's a 4-3. Vote against. Is there a specific question that you feel that you could ask him directly? He would still be here to ask.
My question was more appropriate for executive session. I'm going to have to think if I want to ask it in public session.
For those who voted against going into executive session, do you have any other questions or do you want to make a motion?
Well, I don't have any questions. I'd like to make a motion that we authorize the manager to execute a quick claim deed to the Guevaras for the property.
Second.
Discussion? Councilor Jordan.
I just want to say is I think, I don't know whether it's a policy or what we had done in the past for a good number of years is get the taxes paid up to date and give them a quick claim deed. And I don't see why we should change from that on this one. Well, over the years, we have done it the other way, so therefore, I will second that motion.
Councilor Reed?
I'll make the statement out loud that I would have made in executive session, and then I can be told to stop talking, and I will. The primary difference between past practice in this is that this is not a primary residence. This is not owner-occupied. And my concern, as I've said on the council previously and recently, that taxpayers who cannot afford their taxes have abatements denied. And I think it's unfortunate that we're in a situation where people, maybe due to an honest mistake, cultural differences, or whatever, have not paid their property taxes. But I do believe that there's a remedy under the law with foreclosure when people do not meet certain deadlines, and that there is a responsibility with ownership, and that responsibility means you meet certain deadlines. I'm not inclined to vote for a quick claim deed at this time to be authorized by the town manager.
Councilor Chappell, did you have a hand up?
Yeah, I just wanted to explain it just a little bit so that nobody gets the wrong idea, because that's probably the hardest motion that I've made in my 5 years on the council. I don't have too much sympathy with the present owners going for that long a period of time, and I don't care what the excuses are. Business is business, and no matter what country you're in or where you are, you should know when things are due. If you've paid them before, you would know. So I don't have any sympathy there, but my whole part of looking at this for the last 3 days and talking about it to myself, is what has been our policy in the past, and I cannot find any time in the past when somebody hasn't paid their taxes and it's been foreclosed, that we haven't come up with a quick claim deed upon the payment of those taxes in full with penalties. I can't see whether it's an $800,000 house or an $80,000 house. I can't see where it has anything to do with it, who the people are. I think we've got to stick with the same policy until the council sits down and makes a different policy for us to follow. I don't think we can just take one piece of property and change the policy for that one piece. Thank you.
Thank you. Council McGinty.
Madam Chair, I listened to what Dr. Rivera said, and you know, I believe he's an honorable man. However, I think there's a big difference. I think we're setting a bad precedent when we have, if we have citizens in this town who have an inability to pay. I think there's a big difference between that and basically I forgot. And you know, I just can't see that, and I can't buy into that notion that I forgot to pay my taxes. And so I will be voting against the motion.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I've had a number of citizens talk to me about this issue, and I too have done some long and hard thinking about it. I know what it's like to be in a situation where taxes aren't being paid. And I'll give you my quick story. With another family member, I'm responsible for a property in another community. Neither one of us lives in the property. I was extremely embarrassed to discover that property taxes had not been paid on that property last fall. This is a family member I may not get along with all the time, but for something like that, you initiate the conversation. You make sure all the bills are being paid. That bill was paid with interest. We have a fair number of citizens in this community who sacrifice, do without some things in their lives so that they can pay their property taxes and they pay them on time. And I feel as a counselor, I have to do what is best in my mind for the majority of the citizens, what is right. And I don't think it's fair to the overwhelming majority of our citizens. What, we have a 98% collection rate? For them to be paying their taxes when they're supposed to, the way they're supposed to, and then turn around, regardless of the amount of outstanding taxes in this kind of situation, especially, I would agree with others who have spoken, it's an unoccupied home, it's not a primary residence, and say, oh, sure, you know, give us the money, don't worry about it. I think it casts a pall on the whole lien system. That's why we have a system in place. That's why the state has that system in place. People have plenty of time. There are avenues that have already been explained this evening for addressing the town and saying, I can't pay my taxes, they weren't paid because, and get caught up within 18 months. I'm not going to support the motion.
Any other comments? Councilor Nell.
Well, I hope none of us get sick in the next hour or so, because if I was Dr. Guevara, I'd walk right out the door. But I don't think he's that kind of man. I think what we have to think about is, are we a community of friends or opportunists? We do have a high rate of people paying their taxes on time. It's one of the highest in the state, and I don't think that the town has suffered because these folks have been late with their taxes. They've produced a check for the full amount. If we want to revisit as a policy some sort of a penalty, I think that's something that we could do in the future. But I'll tell you, I don't want their money, and I think whatever we built with it would be a monument to our greed. You know, and I understand that people do make sacrifices in this town, and I do too, to pay our taxes. And But I think that, you know, there's limits to how severe you can be. I know, in the Mideast, someone can steal a loaf of bread and they'll cut the hand off, or they used to. I think that's kind of severe. I mean, you teach them a lesson, they'll never steal another loaf of bread, but I think that's just too severe. And so this is embarrassing, I think, and I hope we give these people their house back. And if we need money, I just don't think we need it that badly.
Thank you. I think part of the something that has generated this particular, what's become a controversy, is that there are some citizens in town who feel that we, because we supposedly have foreclosed on it, should just automatically sell it. That has not been a practice in this town. It never has been. And I concur with Council Linnell and Jordan and Chapel that we should follow past practices. If we're going to change our policies, we do it after we've made this decision and use it for future decision-making. I think it is, I concur in being a little embarrassed that this has been drawn out so long, and I can understand perhaps because of two cultures and two countries' procedures being commingled. Nevertheless, I think any kind of a business, and I'm sure it's true in Dallas, that one of the best ways is communicating in writing, not just telephoning. It's just a good verification. You can leave a trail. Or fax machines, even today. So, you know, I think that perhaps it was the stress of having your helper no longer available, but it still would have been a much more thoughtful, careful, good business practice to have notified the town, particularly in writing. So I'll call the motion. Those in favor of Gary?
Madam Chairman, I'd like a roll call vote, please.
Fine. All those in favor of granting the quit claim deed?
The roll call?
Right.
Councilor Chapel?
Yes.
Councilor Jordan?
Yes.
Councilor Linnell?
Yes.
Councilor McGinty?
No.
Councilor McLaughlin?
No.
Councilor Reed?
No.
Chairman Cogsall?
Yes.
Motion carries 4 yea, 3 nay.
So the manager will be signing the deed, and you still have you'll have your property back. In the morning? In the morning. On to item number 101. To consider establishing a proposed pool study committee and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern, do you want to give a little background on this? It's been such a long... You're very welcome. You're very welcome.
Yes, Madam Chairman. The pool is now approximately 25 years old at Cape Elizabeth High School, having first been built when the high school was first constructed. Recently, the school department arranged to have a study done of the pool. And what that showed was that it was really beginning to wear out as a result of the high humidity and as a result of the temperatures, and I think everyone can understand when you're in a real damp atmosphere like that. Anyway, it appears that the pool will need some work. The extent of it really needs to be determined, and it was suggested that the school department and the town departments work jointly on that. So the council discussed this at a recent workshop, and what it provides is that it would be a committee consisting of a town council member and a school board member, each chosen by the chairs of their respective bodies, and a member of the Community Services Advisory Commission, jointly chosen by the chairs of the town council and school board. The town manager, superintendent of schools, and director of community services, or the designees, would be non-voting ex officio members. The purpose of the committee would be to review the condition of the pool, including the wing around it, the building, and make recommendations as to whether or not the town should undertake repairs and improvements to the pool. If they affirmatively believe that repairs or improvements should be undertaken, then a specific proposal should be prepared for town council and school board review. The committee would be charged with assembling information on the extent of pool use and considering the effects that any pool construction program would have on programs and activities housed at the pool. The committee would review options for management of the pool and would prepare a financing plan for any proposal involving taxpayer funds. It's proposed that the committee have an appropriation of $15,000 from undesignated surplus for any engineering studies and plan preparation that might be required during the evaluation, and that I would be involved with approving the hiring of any consultant, which is the standard procedure. The first meeting would be held sometime in February, and the committee would make a preliminary report to the town council and school board no later than June 30, and the committee would issue a final report by September 1 of 1996.
Thank you, Mr. McGovern. Counsel Reed.
I understand we're not appointing the members of this committee tonight or recognizing them, but I did want to ask regarding the language about the community service advisory person being approved by both chairs of the school board and the town council. I was wondering if we could end that sentence after community services advisory board. My question is, why does the school board and the town council chairs have to agree on the membership on the pool committee when they have agreed on the membership of the community services advisory board?
Well, we've already agreed, so it's a moot point.
Before this was accepted?
Right.
Okay.
Counselor McLaughlin.
Madam Chairman, I'm going to propose a motion that we approve this, establishing this committee as presented with an amendment now passed down for the counselors on that side of the podium, the material that the manager was good enough to prepare for me this afternoon with a proposed amendment. It's the last sentence on this amended draft. And this is something I'm basically going to be proposing, you know, for another committee we're considering creating this evening for future committee, ad hoc committee creations, that specifically committee members are specifically encouraged to attend any town council workshop or meeting at which their proposals are considered. I bring this forward based on experiences actually in another community where I was distressed to see that people who had worked long and hard with an ad hoc committee did not attend and participate when they had a chance, when council was discussing their report. And I don't want anybody appointed to one of our ad hoc committees to think that they are done once the report is submitted. I want them to understand that there's an ongoing obligation, in my mind at least, and hopefully in the rest of the council's mind, that they come and help explain to the council any questions that may be raised and give some of their thought process if necessary. So that's why I'm offering the amendment to the motion.
So you made a motion with this amendment?
With an amendment, yes.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion. I guess we're just taking preventative action just in case we have a group that feels like the ZOR committee that maybe they've really finished when they finish after 2 years' work, but I don't think you'll have to worry about that group.
Madam Chairman?
Yes.
I just didn't quite understand what she was going to. So you feel that some members of the committee might quit before they make the presentation? Is this why the idea?
No, and since this is only a three-person committee, I'm not really overly concerned about them following through. I think our general procedure is we receive a report from a committee, and we then go to workshop on it, and then come back for council discussion or refer it out to somebody else if need be. I want to make sure that committee members in that kind of situation understand that their presence at that workshop discussion and potentially the ensuing council meeting when it's discussed and voted on is something that I would like to encourage. I'd like them to be there when we're talking about it in workshop after they've given us their report.
Well, I kind of agree with that, and I have no problems with that, no problem with the motion, but I'm just wondering, we have problems in the past of any members ever not attending meetings that we felt should go on? Do they don't fade away once they turn the report in if we want them for something? I mean, I think you're kind of blaming some of the people in the past when you put this amendment on it.
I'm not blaming anybody in the past because I can't give you an instance when it's happened. I think it's, as Chairman Cogsall said, it's more preventive, and being a member of the appointments committee, I think it will help the appointments committee when they're interviewing people for some of other kinds of ad hoc committees that we create, for them to be able to say, yes, and these are the obligations of being a committee member.
Okay, I'm not going to argue with you anymore, but I'll move on.
Any further discussion?
Could I hear that, the motion again, just?
The motion is to.
I just wanted to hear, that's all.
The motion was to approve establishing a proposed pool study committee as presented with the amendment that I proposed. The amendment is the last sentence on that. Other than the last sentence, which is in bold italics and underlined, everything else is the very same language you had previously.
Okay, thank you.
All set, all those in favor? 7-0. And I'd like to respond to Councilor Reed for the fact that she raised her eyebrows that we'd already agreed on someone from the Community Services Advisory Committee, but then I had already asked her to be on the committee before this meeting, too. It was just that they have such an early start, they have to have their first meeting by March 1st, we might just as well get it moving, and I am very proud to announce tonight that from representing the school board would be Gail Dransfield, Community Service Advisory Committee, Karen Dunphy has willingly volunteered her time, and from the town council, Rosemary Reed. She was concerned at first when I asked her because she is running for reelection this spring, and I assured her that if for some reason she should not be reelected, that she still would be very welcome to complete the work. And I think her background as being a former school board member as well as a councilman member brings to this committee extra wide dimension as well as her business expertise and figures. So I think we've got an outstanding committee. Now on to item 102, to consider a proposed policy to govern projects on municipal property and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairman. Back when the ball field issue came up a year ago, there were quite a few letters in the file from citizens at the time indicating that they were quite concerned with the process. I read one today, I think went on for 6 pages, with concern about the process. As a result of many of those concerns, you, Madam Chairman, asked me to develop a draft policy for council consideration that would indicate how the town would go about with the application process for any proposal that was on town land or within a town building. This policy was developed. It was reviewed at a workshop on January 22nd. What it provides is that any of these projects that the town itself would be the applicant, the manager would be responsible for obtaining all the permits and for coordinating presentations before different review agencies, be it local building permits, state or federal permits. Then any private groups interested in a project would be very welcome to represent their own interests before the board, but it would be recognized as representing their interests and not the town government itself. The town council would review plans. This would kick in reviewing plans for any project over $25,000. That was an amendment that came about as a result of the discussion at the workshop. This would exclude electrical, plumbing, dig safe, drainage projects, or emergency repair projects. It would be a two-step process for you to look at the plans. One is to initially approve funding and project planning and preliminary design, and the second would be for approval of a specific application or plans to be submitted. Community groups would be welcome to participate in the process. However, they would be strongly discouraged to do any fundraising for projects proposed for town property without first reviewing it by the council, so that we didn't have a situation of someone out there raising money for something on town property without the town having, council having first indicated that was something they might entertain. Make it clear that anyone providing financial support can provide input into project planning. Even anyone who doesn't want to give money could provide input into project planning. But the ultimate decision on what shall be the scope of any project would be the town council's. Finally, that there's sometimes issues of use of municipal resources, public works, or us accepting the funds. On any of these partnership-type projects, the extent of municipal funding and whatever municipal in-kind donations that might be provided would be spelled out by the council on a case-by-case basis rather than having a blanket policy on that. So that is the proposal that's before you this evening.
Thank you, Mr. McGovern. Councilor Reed.
Yes, Michael, I have a
request for clarification on the roles of community groups and individuals, second sentence. The town council strongly discourages any fundraising to occur for projects proposed for town property without prior approval of the town council. Is the town council approving the project or the fundraising event in that sentence?
It's intended to, my English teacher might not be too pleased with this, it's intended to refer to fundraising.
So you want each individual fundraising event approved in advance?
No, the intent here is general fundraising, that, you know, if a, and that's always has been the practice, if something's really been going to be going on town property, before someone goes out and raises money and gets the hopes up that something's going to happen, that first they have a reality check with the town council to be sure that, that in fact this is something that the council would entertain. And, you know, and I think it's generally thought of in terms of some of these larger projects, but I can think of a controversy, oh, 5, 6 years ago involving an equipment building on school property that became very, very heated as to its location and how it was being paid for and other issues. So, you know, the council as the custodian of the property for the body politic of the community needs to make those judgments.
I have a follow-up then. I happen to know that there is an event scheduled for April with Schooner Fair. It's been in the works now for 8 months. I was wondering how that would be looked upon after this policy is passed, since it's already been...
Does this Schooner Fair fundraiser have anything to do with improvements to town-owned land and buildings?
Yes. And it was in good faith booked prior to this policy, which, as we know, is a reaction to the last year and a half's events.
I haven't heard of this instance. I'm not too sure what it applies to, but
the Rotary's involved.
I know the Rotary's had trouble getting that date booked, but I don't know what the charitable purpose is.
Fields for Cape Kids.
Yeah, if it's Fields for Cape Kids, I think in that particular instance, the council has authorized fundraising.
I'm just making sure that it's on the record.
And I don't think the council ever canceled that recommended fundraising, authorized fundraising.
Thank you.
Other comments? Councilor Jordan.
Well, I just got an offhand comment. I kind of agree with this policy, and I think it's good thinking, but I just don't understand why any organization, if they're going to have a fundraising for a community, that they wouldn't let the community powers to be know what they're up to. And it's too bad we have to write a policy to steer them down that right road.
Is there a motion on this item?
Yes.
Councilor Reed?
I move that we make, I move that we authorize the new policy on the improvements to town-owned lands and buildings.
Second. Discussion. There being no discussion, I'll move the question. All those in favor of establishing this policy? The 7-0. Item number 103.
Madam Chairman, following a January 22nd workshop...
Oh, wait a minute. I was going to...
Oh,
To consider a proposal to obtain engineering services for studying the feasibility of ball fields at Lions Field and Fort Williams Park and take any necessary action. This is an item that was sponsored by Councilor McLaughlin. Would you like to give us the background?
I'll give you the background of why it was sponsored by Councilor McLaughlin. I believe I was so directed at the January 22nd workshop, and because of my capacity as finance chair, I assume that was why I was so directed. Regardless, I'm doing this. Last year, we heard a number of objections from the community to some proposals that were being put forth about playing fields. At that time, the council said that they would listen to the objections and do what they could to address them. People wanted us to look at other sites in town that might be appropriate for playing fields. People wanted us to see if there really was a need for more playing fields. We were asked to work with the land trust in helping to identify any of their properties that might be appropriate for playing fields. And we were asked to look at the process that we went through, that the council would go through when improvements were being proposed on town property. That final one, we have just formally addressed with the last item. The council chose to do this by having a subcommittee take charge of it. This is what we tend to do with our council goals, and we tend to have two councilors shepherd a specific goal through the process. The council subcommittee for this goal of looking into the need and location for potential playing fields was taken on by Councilors Coxall and Chapel. They presented a report to the council last fall. The manager assisted them with a lot of the work. The Public Works Director, Bob Malley, assisted them also. I don't know if there's any other staff involved or not. We also had a workshop last August where we, and I didn't bring it tonight because I'm tired of carrying all this paper around. We had reams of information on the scheduling and needs of different teams throughout the town, throughout the year, for outside playing fields, be they in the configuration of a rectangle or be they in the configuration of a baseball, softball field. We worked with the Land Trust. The Land Trust, I believe, came back to us and said that they did not have any holdings of property that would be appropriate for locating playing fields. When Councilor Coxall and Councilor Chapel turned in their report, they looked at Lyons Field, they looked at the refuse disposal area, they looked at the Thomas Jordan land, formerly known as the Poor Farm, they looked behind Town Hall, they looked at three places within Fort Williams. Within Fort Williams, those included the park entrance field, the parade ground, and the area by the maintenance building. Their report, as I have said, was discussed by the council in a workshop last month. As a result of that workshop, it was decided that there were two potentially viable locations for playing fields. This is after the council, from all I can tell, has been convinced that there is a need for more playing fields in the town. The two locations are the Lyons Field area and the maintenance building area, for lack of a better term, in Fort Williams. What I was directed to do was to work with the manager and come up with what the next step would be, because the council wanted more information, they wanted some engineering data and presentation about the feasibility and the potential cost of creating different kinds of combinations of fields in those two locations. We had a morning meeting on that and went to one engineer. This was not something that had to go out to bid. Last spring, the firm Harvey Ost and Associates had done some preliminary work at Lyons Field for the council, and we went back to them and asked Mr. Ost to come up with a proposal. He has done that, and what is before the council tonight is this engineering proposal for multi-purpose recreation facilities. What we're asking them to do is look at a phased approach. It's not saying that if this ever gets built, we're not even saying that at this point. We're trying to get the information. Could it be built? Could the field be built at Lyons Field? We're asking at Lyons Field that they look at a total of two Little League type ball fields and one rectangular field. I'm not going to say what sports have played on it because there are so many. It's a multi-purpose rectangular field. You play a lot of things with different balls on it. Some of them have sticks.
Parking.
Also parking. We know there is a need for more parking at Lyons Field if we're going to have more people using new facilities over there. At Fort Williams, in the maintenance building area, we ask that they look at one Little League-type ball field plus one rectangular field for all those other balls and stick sports. I've heard a bit of concern. Why did you ask them to do so much? You know, do you really think X kind of field is going to work there? No, I personally don't, and I've got some professional expertise in this. However, to make sure that everybody is on the same page with the same information, and it's not just an opinion that is put forth by a counselor, we are asking for something more graphic, something more engineered from the appropriate professionals. I would much rather have more information than I need than to be asked the question later, well, why didn't you think about combining the two fields? We're trying to do it right the first time. I'm a bit embarrassed to say we could have had a lot of this work done for free last year. The council at that time, for various reasons, chose not to. Pay now or you pay later sometimes. I think what we have before us from Harvey Yost is a reasonable response to our request from the engineering proposal that Mr. McGovern and I proposed. I welcome council questions on it. I encourage the council, what I heard a strong consensus from this council at the workshop in January was, yes, go ahead, get more information for both those locations. That's what we're proposing to do with this. Thank you.
Councilor McGinty.
I had a conversation with one of my neighbors today, and she couldn't be here tonight, and she raised a good issue, so I'll bring it up for her this time. Is there any reason why we couldn't do a study of Lyons Field first, take a look at what we have there, what we can do, and then, based on that, move on to Fort Williams? Is there any utility necessarily to having them both done at the same time? Or, I mean, and I don't know, is it financially more feasible to do it at the same time, having the same people do it? Or should we look, I shouldn't say we all agree, but Lyons Field seems to be the primary place that we want to put fields. It's there specifically for athletic fields, and certainly that's our first choice, or at least my first choice. And I'm wondering if we shouldn't look at that first, and based on the information received then, move on to Fort Williams. And I just throw that out for discussion.
Mr. McGovern.
Yeah, I think the sense on it is that, you know, there might be an information vacuum, that as you were considering Lyons Field, you know, there'd be questions as to, well, what would be the relative cost at the other site, and we wouldn't know that, and you would get into the situation again that you're making a decision before you have all the information before you that you ought to have, be subject to that criticism. The second thing is, you know, my sense is, although I can't say 100% this is for sure, you have economies of scale by doing both at the same time rather than dividing them. But, you know, this we requested a response to an outline of a proposal based on the understanding we had with the council's discussion, plus as Councilor McLaughlin was a specific sponsor of this, she was able to provide added input to it. You know, we could ask for something slightly revised. There's no reason we couldn't. Logistically, it can be done.
Councilor McLaughlin.
I could also address that. I think it's the comparison that's very valuable. We have a price comparison, and I think that's something that needs to be taken into account when the council makes its final decision. If you want to go so far as to split this item into two sub-items, one for Lyons Field and one for Fort Williams, that's another thing to consider.
Councilor Reed.
I would caution against splitting those for several reasons, and the first one is we already have preliminary information from professionals who were not hired by the town to do this, and we have preliminary data. What we need is the information that we request that is specific, that is identical in terms of the specifications, the criterion, and the person doing the work. And I think in all fairness to this expense,
In 1985, this need was identified. It has now gone more than 10 years since anything has been done, and I will not vote for anything that is going to delay any further action on this, either yea or nay, but we have got to put closure to this. I look at our agenda item, and our agenda items tonight, do you realize how many study committees we have? Let's stop studying, let's let the experts study, and let's act.
I'm afraid I'm just going to have to interject here if there's anyone else, but Councilor Reed has brought up this 1985 report before at a workshop, and she said that nothing's been done, and that's not true. Several of their recommendations have been done. So I don't think it's been completely ignored. I know there are a lot of people here for this particular item. This is not a public hearing, but I will open up the microphone for some comments from those who want to make brief statements and not long presentations. This is just to approve money for the studies and not any final decision as to construction, which really would end up being a full public hearing. So if you would just kind of line up and give us your name and address and be brief. The floor is yours.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
I just wanted this went into the wee hours at one point. Can we sort of set some sort of reasonable...
We're going to have not 15 minutes for brief comments, I think, after if we reach a point when it becomes redundant.
Excuse me, I'm Bob Schumann. I live in Delano Park. I have a question about the Poor Farm choice. I've asked a number of times, having seen it, it looks like there's almost $0 to be spent to make that a usable athletic field. And I've asked a number of people, why not the Poor Farm? And the answer I've always gotten is sort of a third-party answer, like, well, they say, or somebody says, but I never really know who, that the sanctity of that is based on its view. Now, views are subjective, and evaluations are subjective, but I've seen a lot of calendars with pictures of Fort Williams. I've never seen a picture of the view from the Poor Farm. Why is the Poor Farm ruled out?
Okay, what we're really going to do, ask you for comment on the two proposals we have tonight. I will respond to you later about the Poor Farm, and that was part of the report. The proposal tonight are these two specific sites, and that's what I'm taking comments on now, because that's what's on the agenda.
This does not preclude another site, is this true? Or is it already kissed off? I kind of get the feeling that's already kissed off.
These are the two primary recommendations that we're going ahead with, right?
So the Poor Farm is kissed off?
It was not one of the recommendations to follow, yes.
I'd certainly be interested in an answer. Thank you.
Town Councilors, I'm Carol Fritz. I'm here representing the League of Women Voters, members that are from all parts of the town. I'm surprised that we're here again, I guess, for this particular proposal to have engineering studies for Lions Field and particularly Fort Williams Park. I think the tremendous outpouring that came in June was primarily opposed to developing ball fields in a formal way at Fort Williams. And in the meantime, you had a subcommittee of the town council that I think did seem to favorably recommend studying further fields at Lions Field, but that the three areas they looked at were not favorable at Fort Williams, and yet were having proposed engineering studies to include that. I think it's very likely that engineering studies would look, in terms of dollars, would look favorable if you do them at Fort Williams. But you ought to really be considering the policy of whether they ought to be there in the first place, rather than, and then decide whether you want the engineering studies, not have the engineering studies and the cheap policy, or the cheap outcome decide where they ought to be. just to again state that the League of Women Voters spent a great deal of time in the 1970s studying Fort Williams along with efforts in the town. And we took a position to preserve the fort in its entirety for recreational, educational, and cultural purposes. And the town has implemented many of our recommendations over the years, including saving the Goddard Mansion and the battlements, and having a museum created. There are picnic areas and tennis courts and multiple use open space and walking paths that provide a variety of activities for residents of all ages to enjoy in this setting by the sea. In particular, to the ball fields, we opposed in 1976 having ball fields and fields that were set aside for limited purposes. We felt that open space should be created that's flexible to be used for informal enjoyment of all ages and interests rather than highly organized facilities for single or limited purposes. And we think that is extremely important in Fort Williams. Organized ball fields will add to the dramatically increased use of the park in recent years, putting pressure on the town to increase parking space, which we believe must be limited in Fort Williams. And I think the town has a responsibility to be a good neighbor when it considers activities on its properties and the impact on adjacent existing neighborhoods. In summary, we do not dispute the need for additional ball fields for children interested in Little League. However, we urge the town council to reject this proposal for engineering studies at Fort Williams and favor other options at Lions Field. And I still have not really seen addressed the use, better use of the school facilities that we already have.
Thank you.
My name is Richard Berman, and I live at 1021 Shore Road. And I'd like the council to consider not funding, spending taxpayers' money on the Fort Williams analysis for fields for four reasons. The first one was, last June, I was at that public hearing. There's about half the people here, a lot of people were here, really tried to voice their concern that this was the last quiet part of the park, that this is where there were some trees and wildlife and birds, and where we walk and run our dogs. And I'm in the park every single day since I live right across from it. And this part of the park, I know that Councilor Reed thinks it looks like a dump, that any improvement, anything would improve it. But the reason it's so nice is it is still a dump, that this is the place where the town people go. The rest of the park feels to me like a state park. That's where the tourists go. The tourists don't come over this side. That's what makes it so nice, that it's undeveloped. And this is where we walk our dogs, and it isn't dogs against kids. These are owners of dogs. This is where I meet my neighbors. It's a very, very important part of the park. It is not just a dump. The second reason is, and I hope you can hear this, but this is an opportunity for this council to lead us, to inspire us in their decisions. There's been a lot of alienation, polarization of the town. This is where the council can make decisions that heals this town instead of polarizing it. We need to start to build consensus, not just the power of a vote. I think that this is probably, my heart is heavy that I have to be here again after the last hearing. I really think that there's a lot of healing that has to happen in this town. For this council to start spending money on such a controversial thing, I think would be a real mistake in the healing process of the town. The third reason is I think by spending taxpayers' money on this study of the fort is sort of like adding insult to injury. The injury would be not really listening to all the input that 50%, at least 50% of the people at that hearing gave you. The insult would be using our money to do that study. I mean, it's just like, it's like saying, we're not going to listen to you, and we're going to use your money to study it further. Again, this maybe goes back to the opportunity to heal the town and not divide it. The fourth reason is I do, this is a personal one, but I think this is setting a precedence for any private interest group to come before the town and have the town be spending taxpayers' money. I really think that if, you know, and I'm not disputing the need for fields, but it's the private interest group should be starting to build this consensus and coming to the council with support, not with problems, not with divisiveness, not asking the council to act like King Solomon. And I really think that's where the consensus has to be built. And so I think this is setting a dangerous precedent. So for those four reasons, and especially the healing one, not to create such divisiveness in this town. You can imagine the hearing that you'll have if this goes ahead. So I would strongly recommend that you discuss this and eliminate. I think the idea of looking at Lions Field first and seeing if those fields can't fit there. And not even to consider this. It's just opening up Pandora's box. It's opening up a lot of wounds. It's opening up a lot of problems. And it really isn't listening to the people and realizing that this is the last part of the park that can be preserved for the quietness. And this is the last part of the town park. Thank you for your consideration.
Thank you.
Good evening, I'm John Boomer, and I'll be very brief because the previous speakers have been so eloquent. Just, especially for people who have not ventured out on this cold February night, just to bring them back up to speed, that what we're talking about is Fort Williams Park, which is within this black line here, and that I and many other residents feel that Fort Williams Park already has its share of organized sports fields, two baseball diamonds, and a very large green grass area for playing right as you enter, and then off the end of this other baseball diamond. And I am here to urge you tonight to not do any engineering studies in Fort Williams Park and continue to look at Lions Field, and also to remind you that last June, I handed in 200 signatures on petitions. People took their time to try to send the message to you that leave this park alone. And thank you very much.
Madam Chairman, I'm sorry, but Mr. Boomer's graphic is incorrect. I was sure you were at that workshop and listening to us, John, but you're showing an orientation of that field, which is not what we were discussing and not what we're proposing right now. Could you please make that clear to your audience?
I'm sorry. Last year, the rectangular field was run this direction, approximately north-south. This time, this supposedly new proposal is on the same piece of land, but just running it east-west. And it was not clear at the workshop meeting that there was even going to be thought about a baseball diamond, so I don't even know where people are talking about. There's no picture of that with the letter I received.
Thank you very much.
Ruth Pitsley, Old Fort Road. I can't say better what has already been said so very well, but I think you're going to run into a tidal wave of opposition if you try to do anything with Fort Williams. It is precious property, and a special park, as you in your report called it. It seems to me that we should almost come to a screeching halt and have some kind of an overall plan that will not result in repetition of controversy and a guideline by which we can act when these things come up. That land that was set aside at four parks, four ball fields, Lions Field, shouldn't be ignored any longer. We should call off any kind of work for ball fields until we have the money to do it right and to do it at Lions Field. And Mr. Linnell maybe would even be willing to donate his property to the town so that the field could be larger and better and take it as a tax write-off.
See, Bill, your time's not enough.
Thank you, Mrs. Petzl.
But, I guess I've said enough. I can't think of anything more to say, but it is important. It is terribly important. And don't spend the money engineering studies on Fort Williams Park. It's obvious the reason for it is it will come in much costing much less, and that will tilt the scale.
Thank you. We have 2 minutes.
My name is John Chapman. I live at 77 Hillcrest Road. I don't think I can make the case any more eloquently than Councilor Reed has, that the next logical step in this process is obviously to conduct an engineering study of these two locations. By my count, each and every town councilor is on record officially as acknowledging a substantial need for additional playing fields for our kids. The town's own studies, consistent with studies that the private group has conducted, has shown that there are two reasonably available, there are two possible sites in this town for ball fields, and those are Fort Williams and the Lions Field area. We can study it for the next 10 years. Those are the options that are available right now. It seems to me that unless this council is prepared to turn its back on this obvious need, the next logical step is to conduct an engineering study.
Mr. Dunphy will be the last one. We've already gone over our 15 minutes, and I think we have a general consensus here. I'm sorry,
Roy Dunphy,
get in line in time.
At 23 Columbus Road, and I'd like to encourage the council to vote for this engineering study. We know there's a great need. And I think what we're really talking about here at Fort Williams and at the other site, Lions Field, is simply sharing. This is a 3 acres out of a 99-acre park at Fort Williams, 3 acres. The other sites there are not manageable for any team sport. They're dangerous sites, and that's why they haven't been used. So we just want a safe place for our kids to play. Thank you.
Thank you.
Just a correction, the park is closer to 90 acres than 99 or 96. I don't wonder where we got our extra 6 acres.
Is there?
No.
No? Okay. Yes, it was private. I'm sure many of the other councilors have received calls and letters, as have I. I have not received one that has been in support of our examining the fields at Fort Williams. Before we actually have any motions, I think I would like to have us as a council discuss the proposal and ask any questions, because I would sort of favor having separate votes on each of these fields. Are there any questions to the proposal that is before us tonight that you have, Councilor Reed?
I have a comment. Probably the reason that no one from the proponents have responded is there was an article in the Portland Press Herald where a councilor was quoted as suggesting that this will be a 7-0 vote in favor of funding this study. So I just think, in all fairness to people who are wondering why there's no literature from those in favor, the ones that spoke to me referred to the article that was in the Portland Press Herald the day after our meeting. I think the record should reflect that.
Fine. Maybe I should bring this up now, because I was also talked to the reporter the day after our meeting, and my recollection, and I thought I repeated it three separate times, was that the study would involve Lions Field for two Little League fields and to investigate a rectangular field along the maintenance building. And the proposal before us tonight, I don't object to the addition and exploration of a rectangular field, as Janet wants to call it, at Lions Field, because I think we need to do a complete study of that, since that is supposed to be the focus of recreational fields. But I do have questions about references to the plan, preliminary site plan, that was dated last April that Mr. Ose makes reference to, and the fact that he also makes reference to exploring a Little League field, because we didn't really come to that kind of a consensus that night, specifically addressing that. Now, if we're going to have a debate, fine.
Madam Chairman, I don't intend to debate. I intend to explain to you that, as I've said previously this evening, I want to get as much information, and I think the council deserves as much information, as broad a scope as we can look at, rather than having somebody come back and second-guess us later. I think we're remiss if we don't do that. If we are spending taxpayers' funds, as we've been reminded of by more than one speaker tonight, that we do it very responsibly, and if that wasn't your understanding that night, that's fine. I think we owe it to ourselves and everybody who's helping to fund this through their taxes to get a lot of information, and you do that all at once so you can make an educated and an informed decision.
Do you want to explain exactly what this site plan is that he references?
Site plan he references
original proposal for the original layout?
Something similar. We had a very generous offer from a landscape architect who did some work last spring for the
Fort Williams Park, I'm referring to.
For the proposed multi-purpose field for the Cape Elizabeth Fields. What I'm looking at is dated February 1995. A copy of this is what was passed on to Harvey Ost. There's some other topo information on at least one other drawing. There was also a written report, quite lengthy, also prepared by that landscape architect. We were lucky to have that information to get Mr. Ost not at square one, but perhaps at square two with some base information.
I think the importance of that and referencing it is Councilor McLaughlin slightly alluded to. It's not the physical layout of how any improvement would occur in that area. What is on that particular plan, particularly the two-foot contours, which are a very important part of developing any plan, is you want to know the contours. And that particular plan does show those contours, and that's why it would be used as a basis. It's knowing what's there underlying, and it's not going to be used in terms of the specifics of any field layout.
But the dates don't even correspond.
No, but the plan Councillor McLaughlin's referring to doesn't have all those two-foot contour lines on that April plan.
The April one does.
Does have those two-foot contours.
Okay. Councillor McGinney, you had your hand up.
I was going to concur with Madam Chair that was my understanding also, that we were simply going to look at a rectangular field. That's the term we're using tonight, at Fort Williams. And to clarify, make sure that we understand that we're talking about the field we're going to look at is going to be an east-west configuration as opposed to the configuration in the plan that we're, the site plan we're discussing.
It's parallel to the maintenance building.
However, I think Councillor McLaughlin makes a good point. If we're going to have the engineers out there, and you know they're there on site, and it's part of their proposal to look at a baseball field too. You know, it seems like no big deal to me to add that as far as an engineering study goes.
Councilor Chappell.
I think we have to be very careful. I read this at home and I was kind of disturbed, and I want to explain what my problem with it is. And that is that that night when we talked over the different plans and talked over what Phyllis and I and Bob Malley had walked, There was nothing in our proposals that we gave to the council for this old plan going back to 1995 for the Fields for Cape Kids. And I think the minute that you give those plans to the architect that's going to, or the engineer, whoever he is, that's going to do the work for you, that he's going to say, oh, look at this, that's good. Well, we don't question that probably that field can be built there. But there's some of us that don't want it there. That particular first proposal that came across. I can remember very clearly at 12:30 at night when I said, gee, if you'd only come in with some alternates instead of just that one field that sits right there and runs right down towards Delano Park. And I voted against it. I would again. But I fully support the engineering money. I can't go along with some friends that I've heard that have been against that because I think we need something. I'm so tired of hearing on ball fields and bikeways, we're going to do this, we're going to do that, and nobody knows whether we can or not. This bothers me when you're supposed to make a decision that you don't have enough to go on. Councilor McLaughlin is absolutely right in more material. I'd like to know, can it be built, what it's going to cost, how it's going to affect the neighbors, how it's going to affect parking, how it's going to affect drainage, the scenic vista question. I think if it's scenic vista up at the transfer station, why Fort William comes into the same thing as a scenic vista, I think you have to compare the two. And so I have a lot of problems, and the only way I'm going to be able to get rid of those problems and make a good decision for the citizens of Cape Elizabeth is if I have enough information, which I can't get out of, we can do this, we can do that, we can do this. Once we have that information, then we can make a decision. I do like Councillor McGinty's suggestion that we exhaust the Lions Field to its fullest. Because if two ball fields and parking and a soccer field can go into Lions Field, I firmly believe that's where it should be. That's what it was given to the town for. That's what we should use it for. Now, if this engineering study brings up that we can only get two ball fields in there and we can't touch a soccer field or lacrosse field, then I am open to further study over in some other area. Definitely. Not ruling that out. But please do not think that the council is going to sit here tonight and just say no to any engineering, because it's very important that we can't make a decision on anything. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Linnell.
I think one of the reasons that this issue was so divisive back along when it was discussed before is that the way it wound up, it was either it was sort of an all or nothing. Either it's all at Fort Williams or nothing. And I think if we turn around with this engineering study and say, well, let's do it all at Lions Field and look at that, I think we'd be making the same mistake. Then you'd be pitting perhaps some people over there, for one thing, against everyone else. But it's still, you know, we talked about this at a workshop. I don't remember the exact date. And the idea was to, instead of just look at one place and vote yes or no, and then go around and look at another one, that we would sort of get everything on the table and compare them to each other. I mean, everything's relative. You can say, well, this is, I think as a council, we have to decide if we agree that there's a need, what is the best place, or what are the best places, and if we make all our deliberations in a vacuum, whether it's at Fort Williams or Lions Field, I just don't think that's right. And I remember that at that meeting that maybe with one or two exceptions, but I think there was a consensus that there is a need for fields somewhere. People, even those that were against it in one place or another, agreed that they were in supported fields. It was just a question of where, and I just think it would be myopic to just look at one site at a time. I think we'd be making the same mistake that we did back along. So I think we ought to consider them at the same time. Take advantage of the economies of scale. So we know what we're talking about. This is objective information that we'd be getting. Thank you.
Councilor Counselor Jordan.
Yeah, I just have a couple of things as far as a memo goes to the associates. And one of them is that if they get this document, are they supposed to go according to what's in the document? Because it says here on two Little League fields, Cavill ball fields, and one soccer field, youth soccer lacrosse field, an automobile parking for 25. Are they going to look at one ball field and one soccer field? Or are they going to look at two and one?
The Lions field?
Yes.
The intent is to locate one parking lot first, before anything happens. Two ball fields, Little League style, and one soccer lacrosse. The earlier planning with the setbacks indicate that that's the maximum utility of the site if all that could fit in.
So they can't look at one field and one youth soccer?
They could look at just one Little League field and one youth soccer, yeah. They could look at two Little League fields and no soccer. They could look at two.
So they're going to have that flexibility?
They have the flexibility, as indicated in the proposal, to, we've asked them to look at both with a 100-foot setback and a 250-foot setback, which was something I think you specifically had asked for. Plus, you know, beyond that, the OSC proposal indicates that they'll look at any number of alternatives.
Two to four plans
for that particular land. So, you know, as they get into it, you know, they're going to look at the constraints and, particularly, the big issue of Lions Field is two of the three, the wetlands, the contours, and ledge.
Okay.
Those three things are going to drive the decision one way or another, I'm sure.
And I'm not going to go through it because I'd like to move on, and I agree with what Councilor Chappell had to say as far as I think we should move forward here and get some facts and figures on paper of what we can do and what we can't do and what can be built there. So I've had a few phone calls over the weekend to do nothing and leave the fort alone, but I think it's time that we grab the bull by the horns and let's see what can be there and what can be done. I'm not in agreement of what was proposed before, but with the east-west deal, I would like to take a look at that and see what we're doing and get it on paper. See what it would cost.
I think I just want to sort of reemphasize what Councilor Jordan has said, that this vote deals only with doing some research and getting information. It's not a guarantee of any kind that there'll be approval of any kind of facility in either one of these spots, but it's just getting the scientific data. So as long as you can all keep that in mind until we get to the next stage of this process, that is what we're actually considering tonight. It's not okaying a field anywhere. Councilor McGindy.
Madam Chair, I'd just like to clarify that. I'm not opposed to studying, having an engineer study done on both sites at the same time. I just wanted to bring that up for discussion to see how that might fit into the scheme of things. But I'm not opposed to doing them both at the same time.
No, it might be a good idea if we had a motion so we could.
I've been trying to make one.
Yeah.
Is that what you're doing?
Yes. Madam Chairman, I move that we approve a proposal to obtain engineering services for studying the feasibility of ballparks at Lions Field and Fort Williams.
Second.
Councilor, excuse me, Mr. McGovern.
Yeah, I think it's important that there be some dollar amount attached to that
as
and
proposed.
The funding source.
$16,000. As proposed at $16,000.
Second agrees with your dollar amount?
Yes.
There is, I guess I just have one question. Why, when you're considering the extension of a water line at Fort Williams Park, you didn't do it at Lions Field?
I think that's an oversight, and based on past discussion, needs to be included.
Okay. Any further discussion of this item? All those in favor of approving the study? All those opposed? Okay, it's a 5-2 in favor of the study. On to item number 104, to consider a recommendation to commence a process to condemn for municipal purposes a portion of property owned by Lee and Avis Levitt adjacent to the Cape Elizabeth Refuge disposal area and take any necessary action. We'll wait a couple of minutes for those who want to leave the hall can leave, and then we'll move on with this next item.
Yeah, I'm leaving.
You want to take a break?
Yeah, would you like to take a five-minute break?
Yeah, let's stretch our legs, shall we?
Well, Michael always leaves.
Oops, I'm sorry.
Recommendation to commence a process to condemn for municipal purposes a portion of the property owned by Lee and Avis Levitt adjacent to the Cape Elizabeth Refuge disposal area and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern, would you please give us the information?
Yes, I'd be happy to, Madam Chairman. I'll probably speak a little longer on this item than I do on most, but I think it's a significant enough item, important enough item that everyone in the public should be aware of it. It is an issue that the council has been dealing with for some time and is more familiar with it, so particularly if the council members would bear with me while I go through some things that you may have heard in other settings. Back in the early 1990s, the Maine State Legislature approved a plan that required what was known as the closing of all landfills throughout the state of Maine. Initially, it was felt that that probably just applied to the old municipal solid waste landfills, those areas where trash went and that there was open burning. That was later included to also interpret areas where brush had gone, where demolition had gone, tree stumpage, and that type of material. The legislature originally adopted it so that all of these old so-called dumps had to be closed by December 31 of 1992. I was very active at the time in the Maine Municipal Association and worked with other municipal officials across the state to try to get those dates delayed so that the communities would have a chance to respond to them and do some planning. Ultimately, there were a number of extensions to those dates, and it was eventually extended to December 31 of 1995, or about a month and a half ago. The town of Cape Elizabeth was involved in this particular area because we had a transfer station which took care of our municipal solid waste, but we did not have an area that was a permanent disposal site for our brush, for our demolition area, for handling our wood waste and some of those other materials. I think everyone has seen that the area next to the transfer station where they drive out is where that material initially was placed, and then in more recent years has been processed. The DEP, we started looking at alternatives with them. Councillor Chappell, former Councillor Lester Jordan, and others worked for a long time on a site out in the town of Gorham that was going to be developed by Regional Waste Systems for the handling of some of this material. As Councillor Chappell mentioned earlier, when flow control or directing where trash could go was thrown out by the U.S. Supreme Court, it necessitated the fact that that really couldn't be built. You couldn't get the borrowing for that type of investment, so that project died after we made a significant investment in it, as well as all the other communities involved. We also looked at other sites where we could place this material. We did sign a contract authorized by the town council with the city of Portland, providing that anyone in Cape Elizabeth could take material out to what is known as Hamlin's Pit on Riverside Street, which is way out on 302 and the far end of Morrill's Corner. Obviously, that is not an ideal solution because it's so far to go and everyone needs to go all the way through both South Portland and all the way through the city of Portland in order to get to that location. The town then began to look at, you know, if we did bring material that site or we had some other end disposal site of our materials, we still needed to have a place within Cape Elizabeth to process those materials, to accept them from citizens, to bring them to a particular location. We gave some thought to looking at sites other than the general site of our refuse disposal area, but realizing traffic patterns into certain areas, realizing the convenience of citizens to place all in one spot, it was felt that this was the place to look. We began a process with the DEP, as well as with the firm of Wright Pierce Engineers out of Topsom, to look at this transfer station site. To get our bearings a little bit, as you come in Spurwink Avenue, maybe I'll show on this aerial first. This is Route 77, this is the Spurwink Church, this is Riverside Cemetery, this is Spurwink Avenue. This is Denison Drive going into the refuse disposal area. Our property goes across the front here, and then a line just about where I placed that ruler. It's very close to, as you go in the road, following the back lower road of the refuse disposal area. We looked on this particular site, we own quite a few acres there, as to where we might be able to handle some of this material. There were three major constraints in trying to figure out where on the site we could handle the material. The first major constraint was that the DEP, in several meetings that Bill Jordan and I had with them, indicated that they did not want us operating over the old dump. That landfill was to, the old landfill was to be covered, and it was made secure, and that they had very deep and heavy standards as to what would not be allowed and what would be allowed over that landfill. So that essentially, the big flat area that everyone looks at that's now used, we were told you could only use that very, very limited purposes. Then only if you had 36 inches of a clay-like material and another foot of a loam-type material to put on it, which obviously is very expensive. And even then, we tried to put some things up there that they said, no, you're going beyond what we think you ought to do. You've got to find another spot on site for that. We looked over on other areas of the refuse disposal area, away from the adjacent properties closer to Spurwink Avenue, particularly as you look at Rosemary's Bottle Shed, out in back of that, extending on Spurwink down toward the treatment plant. And you really can't see it there, but you might notice a lot of little squiggly lines here. Those are contour lines. And what that shows is about a 22-foot drop as you get to the old solid waste boundary, heading down toward the area where you'd need to relocate that. It's at least 22 feet. The contours of that allow that to be really difficult to do. So that was really the second constraint of the contours. The first constraint was the land itself. The third constraint is something we discovered well into the process, and that was that there's now a Maine law that indicates that you cannot have any type of solid waste activity within 250 feet of another person's property line unless you get a letter from them indicating that they have no objection to that particular use. In this particular instance, we only have one property owner that abuts this particular property. It's a family by the name of Lee and Avis Levitt, and they own the farmhouse that as you go in Denison Drive is just off to the right. We sent a letter back on February 14th of last year to the Levitts indicating that we would like to obtain such a letter. I had a conversation with Mrs. Levitt soon thereafter indicating she had received the letter. She would talk it over with her husband, give it some thought. Subsequent, I didn't hear from her for a while, again contacted her, sent another letter indicating that we needed to hear from her. Nothing really came of it. Again in August, again established contact with the Levitts and actually had a meeting on site with them, at which I gave them a copy of the plan that we were looking at and showed them the issue, gave them another copy of the draft letter that our engineer had prepared, and at that point in time they indicated they would sign the letter.